Hello everyone, and good afternoon from Barcelona. I want to thank the organizers for this invitation and for giving me the opportunity to open today's first session talking about this new functionality of Abinit in which we have been working for the last 3 years. The work I'm going to show to you today has been done in the group of Massimiliano Stengel at ICMAB in Barcelona, by Max, by Matteo Springolo, who is a PhD student, and by myself. But at the same time, it can be considered as a sort of culmination of a continuous research on this topic over the last 10 years, which has obviously involved much more people apart from us three. This is the outline of my talk. First, I will say a few words to introduce flexoelectricity, and then the presentation is separated into sections. In the first one, I will recap the first principles theory of bulk flexoelectricity that has been implemented in Abinit and how we can use this implementation in order to obtain, for example, the bulk flexoelectric tensor of a strontium titanite. The second part instead is more devoted to the surface contributions to flexoelectricity that are always present in a real sample, and how we can use also our implementation in order to estimate these surface contributions. I will conclude by summarizing our main results. Okay, in order to introduce flexoelectricity, let me compare it with a more familiar electromechanical coupling, as it is piezoelectricity. Piezoelectricity describes the macroscopic polarization response to a uniform strain. It is only active in non-centrosymmetric materials, and by this reason, it's displayed by just a few materials. Flexoelectricity, instead, is the macroscopic polarization response to a strain gradient deformation, such as a bending of a piece of material, as shown here in the figure. The interest lies in the fact that flexoelectricity is described by a fourth rank tensor, which means that it is a universal property of all the materials. Moreover, it is expected to be more relevant at the nanoscale where larger strain gradients can be sustained. There is another key difference between piezoelectricity and flexoelectricity, which is worth to mention here. That is the fact that whereas piezoelectricity is well known to be a bulk property, as I said before, flexoelectricity, the flexoelectric response of a real sample will be always influenced by surface-dependent contributions. The first applications of flexoelectricity were mainly devoted to find the cheaper replacements for piezoelectrics. However, more sophisticated applications have been also reported over the years, often involving functionalities which are specific of this kind of electromechanical coupling. For example, the possibility of manipulating the ferroelectric polarization by means of applying a strain gradient with the tip of a microscope, or the possibility to modulate transport properties of a two-dimensional electron gas accumulated in the interface of an heterostructure by bending the wall heterostructure. Or finally, the large increase in photocurrent observed in photovoltaic devices when a strain gradient is again applied on the surface of a material by means of a tip of a microscope. In spite of these sophisticated applications, our understanding of the fundamentals of flexoelectricity is far from being complete. And in this regard, first principles theory can be, of course, a valuable alternative to experimental measurements in order to shed some light on this problem. In an experiment, one typically bends a piece of a material and then measures the transient current. What happens is that the outcome of such measurement will have a lot of different contributions, coming, for example, from the bulk of the material, from the surfaces, but also from domain walls or defects and so on, in case they are present on the material. And in an experiment, only the overall sum is accessible. In this regard, we can consider density functional theory as a powerful theoretical microscope with which we can isolate these individual effects. The problem is that flexoelectricity is very complex to attack from first principles. And the main difficulty comes from the fact that a strain gradient breaks translational symmetry, which prevents us to use the typical periodic boundary conditions that are normally assumed in first principles theory. In the first principles theory of bulk flexoelectricity, this problem has been overcome by the use of acoustic phonons in the long wave limit. Because if we look, for example, at the atomic displacement associated to this longitudinal acoustic phonon or our transverse one, we can recognize regions where the distortions associated to a longitudinal strain gradient or a shear strain gradient are replicated. Actually, this was precisely the approach that Richard Martin adopted in the 70s to study piezoelectricity. That later was also adapted 10 years ago by this different group of authors to study the flexoelectric coupling. More formally, the approach consists in formulating a macroscopic deformation by means of an acoustic phonon, which is nothing but a displacement wave modulated at some wave vector Q. Then the approach consists in performing a long wave expansion of the polarization response to this acoustic phonon in the wave vector momentum. Then at zeroth order in Q, the polarization response vanishes due to the acoustic sum rule, but at first and second order, we recover the response to a uniform strain and a strain gradient deformation, which respectively describe piezoelectricity and flexoelectricity. And another important property of this approach is that it allows us to calculate all the quantities within a primitive cell by exploiting the well-known tools of density functional perturbation theory. In the practice, we need to evaluate a few intermediate quantities, all of them enjoying a similar expansion in terms of translation, strain, uniform strain, and strain gradient. These are, for example, the electronic polarization induced by the acoustic wave. And then we have the atomic forces and atomic displacements that at first and second orders provide us with the force response tensors, the piezoelectric and the flexoelectric one, and with the internal strain tensors. I shall also use a simplified notation, a bracket notation, to simplify the formulas to define some quantities that depend on the sublattice index and a Cartesian direction. For example, the Bohr effective charges associated to a polarization direction alpha will be represented as a 3m vector. Whereas, for example, the interatomic force constant matrix will be represented as a 3n times 3n operator. With these ingredients, we can now write down two very similar equations for both the piezoelectric tensor and the flexoelectric tensor. In both cases, we can split the response in an electronic and a lattice-mediated part. And the lattice-mediated is written in both cases as the product of the Born effective charges times the piezoelectric or the flexoelectric internal strain tensor. In turn, these internal strain tensors, which describe the atomic displacements, can be obtained from the force response tensors, multiplying them by the pseudo inverse of the force constant matrix. For the case of piezoelectricity, this decomposition is enough because both the electronic contribution and the force response tensors are elemental quantities that can be already calculated with the FPT. However, the analogy with flexoelectricity stops here because in the flexoelectric case, both the electronic and the force response tensor can be further decomposed into a clamped ion part and a new contribution, which is written in terms of the piezoelectric internal strain tensor. So in order to understand the physical meaning of these additional terms appearing in flexoelectricity, consider the case of a centrosymmetric material in which there is some optical phonon mode that couples directly with a strain. Since we are considering a centrosymmetric material, this mode would be a Gerade mode, and it will be associated with Raman activity. Then, if we apply a strain gradient, this gradient will also induce a gradient in the amplitude of this mode, which in turn will produce an electronic polarization, which is quantified by this P1 tensor, and a set of finite forces on polar modes that are also quantified by this phi 1 tensor. Therefore, these new contributions can be interpreted as a sort of indirect contributions to flexoelectricity that will be active, for example, coming from the Raman mode in silicon or the tilt of oxygen octahedra in perovskite oxides, as I will show you in a few slides. Let's now summarize at this point what we can calculate with Abinit in terms of uniform response functions. This can be all written as second derivatives of the energy with respect to an electric field, a phonon, or a strain perturbation. And the response functions are well known. They include the dielectric tensor, the force response tensor, or the elastic tensor, when the two derivatives are taken with respect to the same perturbation, or the Born effective charges, and the clamped ion and force response piezoelectric tensors, where two of these perturbations are combined. Well, we have recently extended the capabilities of the DFPT in order to calculate a new set of response functions that can be considered as the spatial dispersion counterparts of these response functions at the left. In this case, they can be also represented as energy derivatives, but in this case, third order energy derivatives with respect to two of the previous perturbations and on the momentum wave vector Q. These four new tensors written in red here are the ones whose implementations has been done in Abinit, and they are the ones that we need in order to build the back flexoelectric tensor. The formalism also immediately allows us to write this kind of third order functional for two other interesting physical properties, such as the natural optical activity or the acoustical activity. And the implementation of these two new spatial dispersion properties will be also done by us in the future inside Abinit. So this is an example of an input file that we can use in order to calculate this fourth new four spatial dispersion tensor that we need to build the bulk flexoelectric tensor. So the structure of this input file is very similar to the one that we would use to run a nonlinear calculation in Abinit. It is a multi-dataset calculation in which the four first datasets, what they do is to pre-calculate the ground state and a set of first order response functions that are needed in order to perform the long wave calculation. At this stage, the only new quantity or the only new variable that we need to specify is this prepa LW, which deactivates the symmetries in the calculation of the response functions to the gamma point phonons, electric field, and strain perturbations, because we haven't yet incorporated the use of symmetries in the long wave driver. Then the proper long wave driver is executed in dataset 5. It is triggered by this new option, this new value of the optic driver variable, and also by means of using this new input variable LW flexo, which the value of ones activates the calculation of these four new response functions that we need to calculate. After the execution of the Abinit run, we will have the typical DDB files for the first order and the second order energy derivatives, and we'll find a new DDB file corresponding to dataset 5, in which we have saved the third order energy derivatives of the gradient response functions. As usual, we will have to merge the three DDB files into a single one by means of the MRG DDB tool. And then we can run the ANA-DDB code in order to build the whole bulk flexoelectric tensor and to write down the different contributions separately. And the input of ANA-DDB is very simple. It suffices with including this flexo flag equal to one, but we also suggest to include these other input variables in order to show also in the output the dielectric and the uniform elasticity tensors, because these tensors are related to some of the flexoelectric tensors or flexoelectric related tensors by means of different sum rules. And therefore we can use the fulfillment of these sum rules as a sanity check for the whole calculation, and also to estimate if our flexoelectric tensor is converged. As an example, I'm showing here the coefficients that I have obtained for the case of bulk cubic strontium titanate. In this high symmetry material, there are only three linearly independent flexoelectric coefficients, which describe the polarization response to a longitudinal strain, to a transverse strain, or a strain gradient, sorry, and a shear strain gradient. And here in the table, I'm showing at the rightmost column the total bulk flexoelectric tensor, whereas the first two columns correspond to the electronic contributions, and here the latest mediated ones. And as you can see, we observe a set of two columns full of zeros, which correspond to those indirect contributions that I was saying before related with Raman activities, which obviously are zero in this high symmetry material because all the atoms are placed in high symmetry positions. But what occurs if we look at the low temperature polymorph of strontium titanate, which adopt this tetragonal crystal structure, in which also the octahedral tilt, the oxygen octahedral experience this antiferrodistortive tilt in the plane perpendicular on the tetragonal axis. It is well known that the amplitude of this tilt couples directly to uniform strain by means of an effect that is called rotostriction. And then this coupling will participate in the total flexoelectric tensor by means of these indirect contributions, as it is observed here for both the indirect contribution to the electronic part and also for the lattice mediated one. At this point, one would be tempted to further analyze these results, for example, in order to figure out which kind of strain gradient leads to a higher or a larger polarization response, or even to compare the relative importance of each one of these terms. However, I have to say that at this point, such analysis is worthless, because the truth is that both the longitudinal and the transverse coefficients that I'm showing here are ill-defined, and only the shear ones have a physical meaning at the bulk level. The reason of this artifact is that the bulk flexoelectric coefficients are only defined modulo a constant, which can be written in terms of the dielectric susceptibility and on the strain derivative of a potential energy. And this is rooted on the necessity of removing the macroscopic electric fields associated to long wavelength phonons all along the calculation of the flexoelectric tensor, which in the practice boils down to impose short circuit boundary conditions. And this is something that is really necessary, since otherwise we cannot even write down the flexoelectric tensor in a tensor form. The origin of the problem lies on the fact that when imposing the short circuit electrostatic boundary conditions, one has to choose an energy reference. And the final result will depend on these joints, because under a strain gradient deformation, the different energy levels of the crystal, such as the conduction band or valence band edges, or the average electrostatic potential, experience a different tilt with the perturbation. In our implementation, we have adopted the macroscopic electrostatic potential, but it was just for practical reasons. And any other choice would be valid as a potential reference. Then the meaning of this additional term is simply what we need to add to our flexoelectric coefficients to shift this energy reference. And this is directly related to the theory of absolute deformation potentials, if you are familiar with. This absolute deformation potential describes the modulation of an energy level in the crystal by means of an inhomogeneous deformation, and they are typically written as the sum of two different contributions, a macroscopic electrostatic one, which now we can obtain thanks to the, with our implementation, thanks to this flexoelectric tensor that we can calculate, and another band structure term, which is equivalent to this additional contribution that basically shifted the energy reference in our calculation. Finally, the reason why the shear coefficients are well defined at the bulk level is because this kind of coefficients originate from the atomic displacements associated to a transverse phonon, And we know that a transverse phonon does not generate macroscopic electric fields. So we don't have to deal with them. Okay, in the last part of this talk, I will say a few words about the surface contribution to flexoelectricity. And I will use again the parallelism between uniform strain and strain gradient deformation. Consider a finite piece of a material, of a centrosymmetric material, in which the surfaces will be always piezoelectric because their centrosymmetry is broken. Then, under the effect of a uniform strain, such as a compression, the dipoles induced at both surfaces will cancel out and they do not participate to the total response of the system, as it should be for a non-piezoelectric material. And instead, if we take this same material and apply a strain gradient by bending it, in this case, the local strain at the two opposite surfaces is anti-symmetric, which means that the induced dipoles will point in the same direction and will contribute to the global response of the system. Indeed, today we know that surface contributions are as important as the bulk ones at any thickness of the sample. For example, in this paper, Max showed that the surface contributions tend to compensate the bulk ones to the point that a different configuration of the surface can even reverse the sign of the voltage response. Another interesting property of the surface contributions is that they are actually the strain derivative of the surface potential observed. And this is a magnitude that suffers from the same reference potential ambiguity as the bulk flexoelectric tensor, but it enters with opposite sign. Therefore, it cancels the bulk one. And we end up with a total response, which is the sum of the bulk contributions and the strain and the surface contributions, which is well-defined as it should be. Okay, the obvious question is, can we calculate these surface contributions in a finite sample with our implementation in Abinit? And the response is that yes. We can, for example, use place a slab in a supercell geometry with vacuum above and below the slab, and we can run the DFPT, the long wave DFPT calculation. But then we need to have to take into account a number of important considerations. The first one is that we need to apply open circuit electrostatic boundary conditions in the out of plane direction, in this direction, which is consistent with the physics of an unsupported slab in vacuum, whereas all the implementation in Abinit has been done assuming short circuit boundary conditions, as I said before. The other consideration is that the flexoelectric tensor or the flexoelectric coefficient is a 3D quantity which involves or incorporates a unit cell volume in its definition. And this unit cell volume introduces an unphysical dependence on of our result on the length that we use to create this this superset. This problem is overcome by looking rather than to the polarization response to the voltage response, as I will show you next. Then the last question to take into account is that as I have said before, in a finite sample, we will always have these surface piezoelectricity contributions, which are not captured by the implemented long wave DFPT formalism. And we need to explicitly calculate them and add them to the bulk-like calculation. So the whole formalism has been reformulated and presented in this paper, where we have written down the formula to obtain the total flexo voltage of a slab or a 2D material under a flexural deformation, such as a bending deformation. And the total flexo voltage has a bulk contribution and two terms coming from the surface. In the bulk contribution, we see here the transverse flexoelectric coefficient as one would obtain from running the Abinit implementation with this supercell geometry. And we see that it is divided by the out-of-plane dielectric tensor in order to convert this quantity into open circuit electrostatic boundary conditions. Next, we have said that this quantity is strongly dependent on the length that we have used in the superset. But so is the dielectric tensor, in the dielectric coefficient, in such a way that the quotient multiplied by the length of the supercell at the end is a quantity which is independent of the length of the supercell, as it should be. On the other hand, we have the surface contributions that can be easily calculated too. They are simply the quadrupolar moment of two charge densities. This is the definition of the quadrupolar moment. And the two charge densities are the first order density to a uniform strain perturbation and the ground state density. These are actually two densities that are written down as byproducts of the main long wave density functional perturbation theory calculation. So it's that we can also obtain them quite easily by an easy post-processing. As an example, 2 minutes, please. Sorry?
I said 2 minutes.
Okay, I'm finishing already. Thank you. Okay, as an example of application, I have shown here the results that we have obtained with the previous formalism to several 2D materials. And in this table, I'm showing here the total flexo voltage and the decomposition into bulk and the two surface contributions. This table corroborates the well-known fact that the bulk and surface contributions tend to compensate each other, especially with this contribution that we call the metric one, which is the one that involves the quadrupolar moment of the ground state density. Actually, this partitioning into bulk and surface terms is probably not really meaningful for 2D materials, where it's difficult to differentiate what is bulk and what is surface. A more interesting partitioning would be, for example, to write down the contributions coming from clamped ion or lattice mediated parts. This is what we also did, and the results are shown in this table, where what we can see is that the clamped ion part is the one that dominates in most of the cases, but not always, because, for example, in hexagonal boron nitride, we see how the lattice mediated part is one order of magnitude larger than the clamped ion. And at the level of the total flexo voltage, in general, we observe a rich variety in magnitude and also in the sign of the final voltage. It is remarkable, for example, to take a look at the case of phosphorine, for which depending on the direction in which on the implied direction in which the bending is applied, our simulations predict a different sign for the induced voltage. Okay, with this I conclude. By summarizing our main results, we can finally enjoy an implementation that allows us to calculate the bulk flexoelectric tensor of any insulator. It is already in the official version of Abinit. One can go to the webpage, download it, and run the calculations. But then there is an important message to take into account, which is that the numbers that we will directly obtain, which will be the bulk flexoelectric coefficients, are not a physical observable. And we will always need to add something to them in order to have something meaningful. And this something might be a band term, which will give us access to absolute deformation potentials, or a surface contributions that will allow us to calculate, for example, the total voltage response to a deformation gradient. And with this, I conclude, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. And I'm sorry I have disappeared when I was supposed to introduce you. So we have some question. It's about strontium titanite. It is unstable. Does the calculation run anyway? Or did you use anharmonic stabilization?
For the cubic phase, I guess. With the pseudos and functionals that we have used, we don't get imaginary modes, so it is not unstable in our case. But we have run the same calculation in other perovskites, that cubic perovskites that are indeed unstable, such as calcium titanite, or yeah. And in that case, the calculation runs, but and you can obtain most of the contributions, but the physical meaning is questionable.
Thank you. And then there is a question about the Abinit tutorial. Do you plan to include these examples or description into Abinit tutorials?
Yeah, that's the idea, but it's something that we are always postponing because there are something more urgent things to do. But yeah, there is a description of all the theory and the implementation in the topic section under the long wave at the long wave chapter, which with this and what I have to tell here today, I probably it's enough to run this kind of calculation. But anyhow, we plan to do this tutorial, but we wanted also to do it once the implementation was much more optimized than now. Now it can be used, but it is not perfect.
Thank you. And so the last very fast question, Matthew is wondering about comparison to experiments, but in particular in 2D materials.
Yeah, that's it's a very good question. It's difficult because there are quite a few experimental results about the flexoelectric response. And
yes.
For example, we have comparisons for the case of a slab of strontium titanate. Actually, these calculations were done by Max in 2015. We have reproduced them with our implementation. And there, the order of the voltage that we estimated was the same that was obtained in experiments. So we are confident about this. But we are also fighting with the referees about this. And one option would be to look at the potential lineup in nanotubes between inside and outside the nanotubes, and to compare with our flexovoltages.
But, okay, thank you very much. There is also a question about the dependence on exchange correlation functional, but we have to really move on. So just one word.
Yeah, for the moment, it is only, the implementation only works for LDA, but I am already working on the GGA implementation.